Joining us now to break down the spending is Adam Roosevelt. He's a national security and defense analyst, a decorated U.S. Army combat veteran, and a member of the GOP Congressional Campaign Committee Board. So, Adam, we look at what's happening right now, and there is a lot of talk about this bill, for example, being too expansive, that there's a lot of things in there that perhaps shouldn't be in a spending bill at this time, let alone one that came out with just a couple hours to go before this big pivotal vote. Do you think that there's valid criticisms when it comes to what's in this bill?
There definitely is valid criticisms, primarily because the time in which this has been pushed pretty quickly. You know, your standard review process for thousands of pages will go through several rounds of review. There hasn't been enough time for that. You know, we see this as traditional. You know, we see military weaponry, we'll see munition supplies, readiness, all the traditional things that are included in the NDAA. However, with current changes to push this through at the last minute, they will sometimes treat this like an omnibus and put things in there that have nothing to do with defense spending. So we do need to audit this and look at exactly what's in the bill, and I don't think there's been enough time.
Yeah, and I think that is what Americans actually have a problem with. They want to make sure that the troops overseas, our military, for example, is taken care of, that if we are going to put an American in harm's way, that they should have the backing of the U.S. government and the American people behind them. But it's when all of a sudden that there's these pet projects that get thrown in there without any scrutiny, really any debate that ever had when it comes to funding for a library, for example. But I do want to focus on the military. Are they properly taken care of when it comes to not only this bill, but in its entirety, really what we do for our troops?
I would say no. I think on standard face value, a lot of people think that just putting programs into a bill will solve the critical issues. We do know that the easy takeaways, the 3% increases are great. We know that there's things in the bill that will address veteran suicide. But when it gets to the effective nature of the program, that's really where the focus needs to really be. But we do need to look at the overall programs and make sure that we reduce anything that's redundant in that bill. And as you mentioned, the side pet projects, which are put in these bills primarily because they're great efforts to talk about national security. So folks will use that as the topic to include side projects that, again, will sideline the national security focus.
And I'm so glad you brought up those points, because exactly what you just said, I have not heard that debate play out in the halls of Congress. I haven't heard why, for example, 3% increases are good. I haven't heard, for example, why there should be money allocated to different parts of the military. I was just told, you know what, the military needs this, and that's why we need to pass it. And I think for many families at home, too, they'll be thinking, you know what, I want the military to be safe. I want it to be okay. Is that really why lawmakers do this? Do they purposely wait until the last minute and then put in their pet projects, and whether it's COVID relief or this latest spending bill, saying, well, the troops need assistance or the American people need assistance? Is this part of the strategy?
You know, I would say that the problem is that we have so many stakeholders putting their hands in the bill. Every state wants a piece of it, every member of Congress, and then you got to get that passed through the House, and then the Senate wants to take a stab at it as well. You've got so many people trying to include what's good for either their constituency or their donors, so you're going to have a tug-of-war process for the duration of this, going into passing it, going into modernizing it, going into editing it, and then effectively up to the president's desk. So it's too many folks with hands on it, but that's our system, unfortunately. But we can do, I would say, the things that are necessary to establish the checks and balances through a proper audit.
And I think that's all people are asking for, is to see the transparency, see the work behind it of where their taxpayer dollars are going to. And I don't think that's too much to ask for. But when we do talk about these massive bills, oftentimes there is a conversation about spending. In fact, Kentucky Senator Rand Paul every year will air his grievances with some of these programs that perhaps should not be getting these elaborate types of fundings. I saw one of them today was about whether or not people eat bugs, millions of dollars going into studies like that. Do you think that there is a time for the U.S. to rein in its spending at some point and really start worrying more so about the budget and the deficit?
You know, absolutely. And I'll just tell you that sometimes these studies, they do have underlying focuses in research and development for whether it be cognitive enhancement. You know, you probably saw recently with France and China, they're doing testing now for genome edification through CRISPR, which is technology to look at the DNA and modify it so the soldiers on the battlefield will be more advanced in comparison to China and France. So I would need to look at what the study's objective is before I make a conclusion. But on face value, it does seem as if maybe it's not advancing the military capability, but we would need to look at it more in depth, and that's why the audit is very critical.
I think that's a very good point. I mean, once again, you just laid out the argument perfectly that there could be a very valid reason behind some of these programs, for example, but we have doubts sometimes because we don't get to see the work that goes into it or the findings behind it or exactly why this money is going into it. I think you bring up an excellent point right there. That is exactly why the American people should have the right to audit all of this information. But Adam Roosevelt, I really appreciate you coming on the program tonight and breaking down this whole ordeal because, as we said, 6,000 pages, something like that, I haven't got to read it, and I'm sure many lawmakers didn't get to read it either. But I appreciate you breaking it down. Thank you.
Thank you.